Hello and welcome to stage three of the Citroën Bay Crits. It's the final day of racing. The men's has been about to be concluded. The women's has just been won by Ruby Rose Manganon. In the battle, Gracie Elvin for the men's race. It's a lot tighter at the top of the general classification than what we saw at the women's, where Ruby had an almost unassailable lead. Now we have Graham Frizzley leading by just 4 points ahead of Brenton Jones. And Brenton Jones will be the fairy tale story. But Graham Frizzley, he's got great form after the win yesterday. Behind Frizzley and Jones, it's then the young Western Australian Craig Wiggins, followed by Blake Angeletto from Bendigo, Kurt Ether in fifth, and Jacob Langham in sixth, riding here as an independent. But the big story is the battle at the top to get the final yellow jersey. Frizzley the favourite?
I think he is the favourite going into this final stage, but I know that Brenton Jones really wants to take this home, and he's got the team around him to do so, especially with Luke Plapp, who's just been exceptional on the front so much the last 2 days. I really hope that Brenton can take home the jersey, but Graham Frizzley has a great team around him as well, so they did a fantastic job yesterday setting up that really tricky sprint. But today, the course is difficult. It's going to be strung out from the gun, no doubt, and I really think that that's between those top two riders and the top two teams. They're just going to be battling it out.
And we saw two riders break away for a long time yesterday. It was Connor Sens in the white colours and also Jimmy Whelan riding in the bike gallery colours. This final corner was the key moment. Jones through the middle, lost all his momentum and the foot came out. Wiggins leading out the sprint, Frizzley with enough to get over the top.
Wiggins did a great job in positioning himself. He just was not quite strong enough to overcome Graham Frizzley. He did a great job. It was unfortunate to see Brenton Jones pull his foot in that final corner. He'd been set up really well by his Bayside Citroën teammates.
Well, Graham Frizzley, he came here not thinking that he was going to ride stage three, a bit like we've seen with Keely Bennett. She decided in the women's race not to ride the third stage because she's focusing on the national championships. The original plan for Graham Frizzley was pretty much the same. Ride stage one, ride stage two, try and get a result, be ready for Ballarat. He's ready for Ballarat. He's got the yellow jersey on, so he's lining up for stage three.
It's very respectful to the rest of the peloton to show up on the stage three if you're wearing the yellow jersey, but it's also very special to take it home and to have your name next to riders such as Caleb Ewan, who've taken out these series in the past. I think that's a pretty impressive series to be able to walk away with.
Some of our best road sprinters have been the winner here. Mark Renshaw, for example. Robbie McEwen won it 6 times. Brett Aiken, Olympic Games gold medalist, was the winner. Our very own David McKenzie's up there on the honour roll as well. On the women's side of things, we've had Georgia Bronzini, multiple world champion, one of the fastest road sprinters of her generation. You've been a winner of it. We've seen Chloe Hosking win it a few times. She's one of the best road sprinters currently in world cycling. So this will be a nice one for Graham Frizzley to put on his CV.
That's for sure. No doubt it's going to be a very hot race here, contested between those top teams. Graham Frizzley's coming from the Kaish Parkup team in those green colours, which is very easy to spot for us amongst all of the blue colours of the other teams. The Bayside Citroën team is really the favoured team to beat, and they've got Brenton Jones there, but they've also got Blake Quick, who won this series last year, who is quick by name and quick by nature, as they love to say. So I think they're going to be pretty difficult to overcome today. And Craig Wiggins, coming from the ARA Skip Capital team, who have also shown that they're really are working well together as a cohesive team.
That team's got great depth. There's Blake Quick with the blue nicks on. The fluoro colours you see in the red and the yellow colours coming up towards the front, that's Jacob Langham, who sits in sixth position in the overall standings. So the top 10 from the general classification, they get invited to the front of the peloton at the start, which on yesterday's course is not so crucial. Today, it really matters. Incidentally, in the race for the Mitchelton Wines sprint classification, the points competition, it's Tom Chester who leads. He's on 7 points. Second place is Connor Sens on 6 points. It's then Blake Quick and James Whelan both on 4 points. 50 minutes of racing plus 3 laps. Cameron Ivory, the Australian National Criterium champion, is looking pretty relaxed, sitting down towards the back. He's in 11th place overall. He missed out by one position to getting the call up to the front.
He is also one to watch on this course. He is the reigning national crit champion, but he's in great form. He's more of a mountain biker. We don't see him racing too much on the road scene. He does a lot of the national road series, but it's great to see him representing that green and gold jersey. He has done well here in the past. He's gained a top 10 and even a second place in 2020. So he could be up for it. He's got some good teammates around him that more are in an aggressive style of racing. The Novacell Bayside Prestige team has the likes of Simon Clark and Ben Hill. So he's got a couple of guys that he can really work off against. And I'd say that they're going to be wanting to be aggressive today and try and get a breakaway up the road early.
Whenever there's a team with Ben Hill in it, I always expect there to be a breakaway with that team represented. Yellow jersey, Graham Frizzly, right in the middle of the picture. He's got alongside him Luke Platt. Brenton Jones is to the other side in the white colours. Jones and Platt, their teammates in this race, riding for Bayside Citroën, along with Fergus Browning, Aidan Buttigieg, Luke Platt, Cam Rogers. And they are a strong team, a force to be reckoned with. They dominated the women's. They're on the back foot now in the men's. It's a lot to make up here for Jones. For Jones to win, he needs to win the stage and have Graham Frizzly finish outside the top three. Jones is going to get to the first corner, first place.
They're probably in a lower gear. That's a bit of a trick from crit racing and mountain bike racing to not be in a big gear from takeoff when you want to sprint quickly into a corner straight away. That Bayside Citroën team was certainly ready. Something that I noticed, Matt, though, was Luke Platt was wearing a skin suit, a long sleeve skin suit. It's not that cold out there for long sleeves. It means that he wants to be as aero as possible out there today because he's probably going to be putting his nose in the wind quite a lot one way or another.
His uncle is on the course. His uncle has got two signs. One sign is for Luke. The other sign that he's got today is for Blake. Power of Plap and Quick by Name. They've got themselves positioned right near the finish line up on the hill. They also can Plap. You can see the signs just there onto the right. He does shoe designs as well. He paints the shoes for both Luke Plap and for Georgia Baker. Luke Plap leading them through ahead of Brenton Jones. One lap down. In less than 1 minute. That was a quick start.
It was a very quick start, but we were definitely expecting that, weren't we? It's a race from the gun on this circuit. You want to be in good position for pretty much the whole race if you can. You want to override it rather than underride it. In other races that have a bit more of an open course, you can sit back a little bit. We saw in the last two stages on the Eastern Gardens course, you could sit in the back of the peloton if you're a sprinter. It wasn't as risky, but on a course like this, you want to be in those top 10 wheels for lots of reasons. It's a lot easier to stay in the front because you're not having to sprint as hard out of the corners. That concertina effect really affects that racing. After not that many laps, you start to get pretty tired. And it's also safer on a course like this. There have been crashes on these tight corners, particularly this corner that they're about to take right after the finish line. Can sometimes even get a bit sandy.
No matter how much they sweep it, a little bit of sand always seems to appear on this corner. They've got the grate to deal with, the white line of the arrow. It just catches your eye. It can impact on your selection of being able to hit the apex correctly. The yellow jersey, Graham Frizzly, you spoke about the first two stages, Gracie, of riders being able to relax a little more down towards the back of the peloton. Frizzly did that on stages one and two. He was second on stage two, first on stage two. Today, the yellow jersey can't afford to relax at the back. He has to stay right near the front from the start.
No, it's great to see he's got a couple of teammates around him. There's a teammate in front of him that he's trying to follow the wheel of. It's nice to follow a trusted wheel. You know that's not going to be too erratic. And there's also a green jersey right behind him too. So you really want to have a right-hand man close to you and often riding behind you, making sure that if you're in trouble, that you've got someone there straight away to ride you back up. If there's been a split or a gap made in the peloton or a crash, they don't have race radios in these short races, so communicating is really important. You want to be around each other so you can have a quick chat, but mostly just to have eyes on each other so you know what the situation is if you've got the green, the yellow jersey there to defend.
Well, there are plenty of green jerseys in the race for the Cash Park Up team. New sponsor taking over from Oliver's Real Food Racing, and it has stepped up another level for 2023. Matt Rice is joining the team for the National Road Series and the other races that they'll be doing internationally. And he returns to racing in Australia after a season with the Lotto Soudal development squad. So the team is getting stronger with more money coming on board, and management is doing a fantastic job. Grace, in addition to all those green jerseys from the Cash Park Up team, there's the green jersey of Tom Chester, who's out there without any teammates.
That's right. Tom Chester has been doing really well in the last two stages to pick up that green jersey. It's no easy feat to pick up those points in the intermediate sprints. Plenty of the top riders want to also maybe collect the green jersey, or at least they're using those sprints to open up the legs for the final sprint of the day. So for him to be collecting points means he's been active, means he's been in good position and also active in some of the potential breakaways that have been going. He's a Canberra rider, so I'm happy to spruik him and the Blackshaw team that he's riding for today, and I really hope that he can walk away with the green jersey today. I don't think it's going to be as easy to pick up sprint points in this race. You can see the pace is just being put on. I think a lot of riders such as Luke Plapp and riders from the Cash team riders from Bridge Lane. They're trying to stay up in those front positions, keep that pace high, and they're the ones that are going to be mopping up those points just purely because of the way that this race is being raced.
And in the race for the green jersey, Tom Chester, he's on 7 points. Connor Sands in second position on 6 points. Also in this race as an independent. He was in the big breakaway yesterday with James Whelan. Blake Quick, who now takes over the head of the peloton, he's on 4 points. So too is James Whelan. So Tom Chester's got quite a few riders he will need to watch. Three intermediate sprints after 15 minutes, 30 minutes and 45 minutes. When 50 minutes of racing have been covered, they get 3 laps to go. They've only been racing for 5 minutes and it has been Quick. Two big Queenslanders at the front. It is Quick followed by Kane Richards. Kane Richards, Gracie, he did not win the national road title last year, but he was the revelation of the race. Plappert was more a confirmation of just how good he is. Kane Richards put in a brilliant ride.
He really did. That's one of my favourite things about the national championships. You get to see some emerging talent really surprise you in those races. They're there in the breakaways. In the men's race, it's the early breakaway that many riders want to make it into, but you have to last the distance. It's such a difficult race. It's a bit of a race of attrition more than anything else. So I love to see some of those talents, those names that you don't get to hear so often, mixing it with the guys that get to race world tour level and see where they get to in the future. So looking forward to the national championships this weekend because it's a great race against the pros, but it's also a kind of a window into the future pros that are going to be emerging from Australian cycling.
And Blake Quick is one of those who emerged last year with his victory in this series. And then also he took a victory in the under 23 race up in Buninyong. Great result for a guy who's reputed as a sprinter to win at Mount Buninyong, even if it's the under 23s, it's a really promising sign for the future.
That's right. A lot of riders that do a lot of track cycling, they just have that great endurance that even if it's for a much shorter amount of time than the road racing, they're able to carry it across and it's quite complementary. So he was very impressive last year at the Nationals and I think that he's going to put on a good performance at this weekend coming as well. But he's already been showing he's in great form at this Bay Series, Criterium Series of racing. So I actually think he's going to be taking home the green jersey today because he's already quite up there in the points and he's just going to be mopping them up while he's on the front looking after his teammates in Brenton Jones.
Another one of his teammates, Luke Plapp, now comes to the front, followed by Brenton Jones. It's then Craig Wiggins. We're seeing the DSM colours for the first time in the race. This is Pat Eddy from Bendigo. He won multiple Australian under 19 titles on the road, in the road race, and also in the time trial. He's here to sharpen the form to get ready for the national championships, which kick off on Friday with the Criterium Sturt Street Ballarat. This is a real heart starter for Pat Eddy.
It really is. The Team DSM is really great at scooping up young talent and I reckon they would have signed him for quite a number of years. They do that on the women's side as well. They scoop up 18, 19, 20 year olds and sign them for 3 up to 5 years sometimes, knowing that they're going to get a lot out of these riders, but that it's a great structured team. They have really great sports science and coaching and support for the riders. So I think that he's going to have a really good experience over in Europe this year.
Fifth place through the corner, that was Tom Chapman riding for Team Bridge Lane. He's the current Australian cyclocross champion. So the bike handling skills are elite and they'll come to good use on this circuit. Bike handling skills on this course are crucial.
They really are. These corners are tight and they're slippery, even in dry conditions like this. I'm always wincing, especially on that final lap when we were watching the women's racing not that long ago, watching that final corner and seeing them dive bombing each other around it. I just always think that there's going to be a crash, but it's amazing how much speed that they can carry through here. The skills of all of these riders are really high.
What do you think the strategy should be for the teammates of Brenton Jones? So far, we've seen Luke Platt, Blake Quick, just set a really high tempo at the front, but there's been no attacks as yet. They need to somehow get the better of Graham Frizzley, and Frizzley can follow this pace all day long.
You're right. It plays into the hands of other sprinters as well to ride the race like this. So the Bayside Citroën team look to be just keeping their rider in Brenton Jones out of trouble, keeping him up the front, keeping the pace high to deter anyone from attacking. But on the other hand, they're also making the riders sitting behind, such as Graham Frizzley and some of the other sprinters, almost getting a free ride because they're also not having to cover attacks, or their teammates are not having to cover attacks either. So it is a bit of a trade-off there in riding a race like this with this tactic.
No attacks yet. The pace has been simply too fast. They've been racing now for a little over 9 minutes. The gentleman that you see in the black jacket, just the other side of the start-finish line, that is Michael Drapac, the father of Damian Drapac, who was the runner-up in the support race in this series in 2019. And Gracie, tragically, he was then killed just a couple of months later on Anzac Day. But out of tragedy, some good has come as well.
That's right. Damian Drapac was a much-loved member of the Melbourne cycling community. His brother, Pat Drapac, is actually in this race, so that's really special to see that that cycling heritage is still going through that family. But Michael Drapac has been arguably one of the biggest supporters, aside from Jerry Ryan, in Australian cycling. He sponsored the Drapac professional team for many years, I think about 10 years, and they were really the team that was helping develop riders that were not involved in the national programs or the track programs. And their ethos was to develop people, not just athletes. And that's a really great ethos that has been carried across into other teams since then. I think it's a really important part of athlete development, especially young athlete development. So the Damian Drapac Foundation is also carrying on some of that legacy, isn't they?
Oh, indeed they are. So Damian Drapac was a kid that when he was at school, he was probably a little distracted and could have done better if he focused a bit more. But then he managed to work out what he wanted to do, and eventually he went on to become a doctor. And he'd qualified as a doctor only months prior to him tragically being killed as he was riding to the Anzac Day race with the Carnegie Caulfield Club. Been working for 3 months as a doctor at the Austin Hospital in Heidelberg. And on the back of Damian's struggle to get into medicine, is not going through the traditional path, Michael Drapac is now created a foundation, the Duda Foundation. That was his nickname. That was his name for himself, Damian Drapac. And they are also funding the Deakin University medical course and supporting two young kids doing that course that don't necessarily get the opportunity to come through the normal pathway, and they get funding to the tune, each of them, of around about $100,000 per year. And there is a research institute within the Deakin University that's been named after Damian Drapac because of a very generous donation from Michael Drapac. You spoke about his philosophy. He lives and breathes it for many of his riders on his team. You weren't able to get on the team if you weren't doing some form of other study. That might have been an apprenticeship. It could have been a course at TAFL University. He wanted to have riders ready for life after cycling, whether it worked out or not in the sport.
That's right. And they also put some money towards road safety awareness because of the nature of the crash that we lost Damian Drapac. So it's really great to see they're developing young riders, young athletes, young doctors, giving opportunities all across the board, as well as promoting safety on the roads in Australia.
Thanks for your great support, Michael, and Duda will never be forgotten. At the front of the race is a rider from the Brunswick Cycling Club, which is the club that Duda rode for, along with his younger brother, Patrick Drapac. It is Luke Plapp, who is at the front. He has spent a long time at the front already.
He has. He's in that aero position in his aero skin suit. He's got that green and gold helmet on with the green and gold bands on his arms, showing that he is the current road race champion. It's a bit cheeky to be wearing those stripes in a criterium race, but we'll allow it, won't we, Matt?
He can get away with it. The current Australian road champion, he was the time trial champion the year prior to that. He's got plenty of teammates. They're trying to come further forward. Fergus Browning and Aidan Buttigieg are trying to get to the front to say, Luke, we can do something to help, surely. Luke could spend all day there at this rate.
He really could. He has got an amazing range of power and abilities. The Ineos team has been developing him into a really top road rider, but I think Oz Cycling want to keep him for as long as possible for the track program. But his Bayside Citroën teammates are also coming to the fore to help. The other national champion's jersey in this peloton is being worn by Cam Ivory. He is the current Crit national champion. He started at the back and he's been struggling to make his way forward because of this high pace, but he's slowly but surely making his way through the peloton there in the green and gold jersey.
Good to see Cam Ivory halfway up through the peloton now. We have in the past seen a few riders who have spent most of the time sitting at the back of the peloton in this course for the first 15 minutes, and they give a little bit of distance coming into the corner so then they can go through the corner slightly quicker and they don't have to charge as hard going out the other side. The whistle has gone for the first of the intermediate sprints. Tom Chester is the leader of that classification with a 1-point advantage over Connor Sens, a 3-point advantage over Blake Quick. We can see the green moving down the outside. Tom Chester has got himself to the front. Blake Quick is following. This is a real battle between the top contenders for green.
This is a great move by Tom Chester. He's using that momentum through the corner. You don't really want to be caught out on that final corner. It is quite a drag all the way to the finish line, but he gapped the field. He gapped Blake Quick, and he's been able to retain those top points. Blake Quick getting second there, and it looks like an ARA Skip Capital rider claiming that one last point for the intermediate sprint.
So it's now 10 points for Tom Chester, 6 points for Blake Quick. Two sprints remaining, and you can get a maximum 6 points. It's not over yet for Tom Chester. He can't relax. He needs to pick up another couple of points in the second of the intermediate sprints, which is roughly 15 minutes away.
That was really great to see him really taking the race by the scruff of the neck, and we were predicting that it would have been a lot tougher today to collect points because of the nature of this course, the Bayside Citroën team wanting to set such a high pace, but he made a really clever move to make his way up to a good position in the peloton and then jump it right before that final corner going into the finish line.
Big Kane Richards now leads them up the finishing straight. It was a brilliant ride by Tom Chester. He kind of got under the radar somewhat with the green jersey on and so many other green jerseys. It's as if they've got the same PMS colour from the Cage team and the green jersey in the race for the points classification.
It is a very similar green, that's for sure. Doesn't help with the black nicks and the white helmet as well, but we're able to pick him out just.
Particularly when he charges to the front after the whistle for the intermediate sprint. This could be the opportunity now for a breakaway to get formed. ARA, Skip Capital, at the front, Kane Richards it is, who is setting the tempo. And it was Kane Richards who went across the line in third position. So he's picked himself up one more point in the race for the green jersey. He's now in equal third position. No, he's in fourth position in that classification. Goes from fifth to fourth. He's on 4 points. A few splits starting to appear, Gracie. The pace, it has been quick all the way through without any major attacks. Bridge Lane now coming to the front.
Team Bridge Lane could want a more aggressive style of race. They have not really been up there in the sprint results yet. Their favourite sprinter in Nick White has been getting top 10 so far, but just not quite able to mix it with that top 5 level of rider. They're going on the attack here. They've had Elliot Schultz in the breakaways in the days past. They've got a couple of other strong riders there that could also feature in a breakaway today.
Team Bridge Lane, it's been around for a long, long time. They've delivered a lot of riders up to World Tour level. Chris Hamilton amongst them, so too Jack Haig, and of course Richie Port was the first big export from them. Nathan Huss is another one, still Von Hoff as well. Is that Tom Chester having had a... That looks like Tom Chester has had a mechanical problem and now rejoins the race.
That's interesting. We didn't really quite catch that. It must have been a very quick change. Looks like he isn't in too much difficulty though. Made his way back into the peloton very quickly, much like Danny DiFrancesco in the women's race, who also had to take a lap out. That's a great example of how to get back in the field. Just pull that pace up quickly as you can feel the bunch coming from behind and slip into the front if you can. Don't wait for the bunch to pass you.
You don't need teammates when you're riding as well as Tom Chester. Bayside Citroën at the front. This is Fergus Browning who leads them through. A moment's respite for Luke Platt. And the yellow jersey, Graham Frizzley, he has not wasted a single calorie yet. He's got great form. He's brilliant on the track. Recently winning the Australian elimination title down in the track carnivals in Tasmania, where he also won the Bernie wheel race, and he won that off scratch. So he's got plenty of speed to boot.
There are quite a number of riders that have done many of the track carnivals coming into this series. That is a big advantage over the road riders. Many road riders have just been doing a couple of months of pre-season training. That includes a lot of volume, a lot of endurance riding, not as much intensity. Usually you start your intensity just in the few weeks before Christmas, and it makes you feel absolutely awful. You have no confidence going into these races. You're hoping your form's okay, and that's what's going to help you bring you up towards nationals. But the track riders have that intensity in their legs from the track carnivals.
We saw Luke Plapp and Blake Quick ride the National Madison title together, and you could see that they didn't have the track legs just at that point in time because they've come off the back of the off-season, starting with the base miles on the road, and they were lacking the normal zip that they would have in that event. They paired up together back in 2018 to win the Junior World title in the Madison. They weren't quite there at the national title just before Christmas, but Graham Frizzley was, and he took out the win when he teamed up with Kel O'Brien. He was flying, Graham Frizzley. a yellow jersey, sitting in around about 10th position. Graham Frizzly, can he join the honour roll as a winner of the Bay Crits, an event that started back in 1989. Peter Saiga was the first winner. There was two series back in 1989. The second one was won by Gary Sutton. Women were introduced to the series in 1994. The first winner then was the great Kathy Watts. Good job being done by Fergus Browning.
Yes, the Bayside Citroën team are setting such a high pace, it's almost impossible to attack over the top of this pace. If you want to get away and the pace is this high, it means you're going to have to ride a lot quicker than that to form a gap and get away. So that's why they use this tactic of setting such a high pace. Riders just cannot attack over the top of this level of speed. If I was the ARA Skip Capital team, I would think about maybe a tactic where you use the riders in third and fourth overall, Craig Wiggins and Blake Agnoletto, to 1-2 the other favourites in the GC. I would use Agnoletto to maybe be more aggressive today to draw out some of the top sprinters, because he can still challenge for an overall, if not top podium position overall. And that's how you can start to draw out some of the other top riders in that GC category and isolate them from some of their teammates.
Mathematically and physically, Blake Agnoletto and Craig Wiggins are still in with a genuine chance. Wiggins is in third position overall, 5 points behind Graham Frizzly. 12 points to win, 10 for second, 8 for third, all the way down to 1 point for 10th place. And Blake Agnoletto is in fourth position, and he's 6 points behind Graham Frizzly. So mathematically, it's still possible for both of them to win. I like your thinking, Gracie. Use one of them to go up the road, the other one for the sprint finish. Team Bridge Lane have got plenty of riders towards the front, but they're yet to launch an attack.
They did try and launch one, but they did not get very far. I think they definitely have an interest in a breakaway today, but as we were saying, that pace is just too high. We can see one of the ARA Skip Capital riders in Kurt Ether. He is one of the larger riders in this bunch. Very tall, very powerful rider, setting the pace as well. So like we said, with the ARA Skip Capital, they've got two riders there in the top five, mathematically capable to maybe take out the series overall. Not sure if they have a good interest in keeping this pace high. It could be a bit of a faux move to try and set up one of their riders to attack, but we'll have to wait and see.
Meanwhile, Brenton Jones follows the wheel of Blake Quick. Brenton Jones is the third of the riders in the white jersey, just behind Blake Quick, who's got the white jersey and the blue Knicks. Big year, isn't it, for Blake Quick, stepping up to ride with the Jayco Alula team, Australia's World Tour team.
It's great to see Aussie talent continuing to get opportunities within the Green Edge family, this year being called the Jayco Alula team. So many sprinters have had opportunities to go across to Europe and learn from some of the best riders in the world. Being part of the Green Edge family for so long, I can definitely attest to the great culture there, the great learning opportunities and support that you get in that team. It's not just about the race starts or salary, it's about being happy in your environment and trusting the people around you. The Green Edge staff are always super professional. You always have your race calendar for the whole year to look forward to, and you don't really have any last minute changes, which is really important to have that stability as a rider in your development. So I think that he's going to get some smaller opportunities to work with some of the better riders and learn a lot from some of those smaller races. And we might see him at some bigger races later in the year, hopefully.
And a great chance to learn from the Dutchman, Dylan Groenewegen. We are hearing that, just as we saw in the women's race with Dani DiFrancesco, when she had a mechanical problem and needed a lap out to rejoin the race, she was then ineligible for the intermediate sprints. Tom Chester has had a mechanical problem, and it was subject to much discussion, but the chief commissaire, Karen O'Callaghan, has declared that because of the amount of time that he had out, he is no longer eligible for the intermediate sprints. He leads by 4 points. For Blake Quick, there's 3 points at the next sprint and 3 points at the one after that. It's out of Tom's hands now.
That's really disappointing, actually. I wasn't aware of that. What happened to Dani DiFrancesco, and I'm very disappointed for Tom Chester as well. You can't help it if you have a mechanical out there, and they tried to get back in the race as quick as possible. So I think he should still be really proud of himself and his efforts over the last 3 days. I think he can walk away pretty confident and happy with his efforts. It's just a shame that he can't walk away with a green jersey as well.
It'll be interesting to see what happens and if Blake Quick does pick up those sprints. Unfortunately for Tom, he doesn't have any teammates that can try and steal the points away from Blake Quick. We'll get a breakaway group of 3-plus riders that don't have any points as yet. It's really a just watch and hope situation now for Tom Chester.
This is a really great angle to see those riders sprinting out of the corner. You could see that top 10 to 20 riders sprinting for a short amount of time, but the riders behind them were having to stay out of the saddle for a little bit longer, and that just shows how much harder it can be if you're in that second half of the peloton, how much more effort you have to do coming out of each corner to retain your position in the bunch and not even make up any positions, just to stay where you are. And often those extra efforts just keep building up. We can see Luke Plapp actually getting gapped here. He's going to have to get his way back into better position. He might have put himself into the red just a little bit in this first quarter of the race.
His teammate Fergus Browning is the rider who is setting the tempo. This is a course that traditionally has been an elimination race, in the fact that riders just get dropped one by one at the back in the peloton. All of a sudden, you look at three laps to go and there's only 15 left in contention.
This race definitely lends itself to being a race of attrition. The head of the race chasing the tail of the race makes it really difficult. And those gaps are more opening up more and more each lap that they go around. This pace is just unrelenting for all of these riders. And it's predominantly the Bayside Citroën team making all of this pace setting happen.
It's Fergus Browning who's done the pace for the past few laps. Team Bridge Lane now coming to the front. Tom Chester is still riding near the front. He's the one in the green on the inside of the corner, just being passed by the yellow jersey. I wonder if he's aware of the decision from the chief commissaire about his ineligibility for the intermediate sprints. And even if he is, I'd still like to see him sprint just for the sake of it.
That's right. You do make it for pride reasons, that's for sure. It's tough to get information on races like this because it's pretty much tunnel vision out there. You're on your limit the whole time. Plus, you don't have a race radio. You're relying on others to be shouting information at you from the side, and it's pretty hard to get that information sometimes. So either way, it'd be nice to see him at least having a go.
Particularly when it's information you don't want to hear.
Yeah, that's right. There'll be some teams that sometimes have a whiteboard out there, which makes that a bit of an easier way to communicate, but you have to know what your team code is. You don't exactly want to be telling the rest of the field what your tactics are either, so that's another tricky part of not having race radios, because if you're trying to get information, there's probably a lot of other riders that can get that same information as well, so you've got to have a bit of a team code as well.
Peloton, as has always been the case in this race around Ritchie Boulevard, strung out in single file. We saw a lot of Luke Plapp at the front earlier on, but he's been drifting further and further towards the back, and now he's in a group that is ever so slightly off the back. I can't imagine Luke Plapp's going to take any big risks on this course a week out from the national championships.
No, he probably had the intention to make a good hard 15 to 20 minute effort from the start, set it up for his teammates to finish it off and get off the course safely. So he doesn't look too worried out the back, to be honest. He could probably close that gap down pretty easily if he wanted to. He probably just wants a good hard effort today and then put the legs up for the rest of the week going into the Nationals weekend.
One rider who has been impressive is Jacob Langham. He rides as an independent in this race. He's got the red and yellow colours on. He sits in sixth position in the overall classification. He's on 8 points. He needs to get another 1 point over the top of Kurt Ether to move himself inside the top five. He's looking pretty good, sitting at the midway point in the peloton, keeping out of trouble. Looking very relaxed, number 21, the yellow jersey, Graham Frizzley. He looks relaxed for the entire series.
He does look relaxed. That's a good show to me of good form. Obviously, he is in good form if he could win that tough stage yesterday. But positioning is a great indicator of form as well, especially in a technical race like this. Riders that are in the best form are able to hold their positions because it's such a dynamic race out there, whether it be a long road race or a short crit, you have to be in good form to hold the position you're in because so many other riders are trying to come around you the whole time. So you need that strength to keep also moving yourself up. So he looks very relaxed, which tells us that he's pretty fit and he's not suffering maybe as much as some of the others are.
Another rider who's looking good, moving towards the front and fourth position with the white jersey and the blue Knicks. That is Blake Quick. They've been racing for almost 30 minutes, so they'll be getting very close to the whistle for the second intermediate sprint. There's Commissaire Karen O'Callaghan, the blue at the finish line on the right-hand side of the screen. And that is the whistle. So this is a sprint lap in the battle for the green jersey.
and the green jersey there, and Tom Chester put his hand up saying, I heard what you said. I think she was calling out some instructions to him, and he's pretty much sat up and been a bit disappointed by that information that he's received. Will he still move himself up and try anyway? I think it can be sometimes a bit confusing. You're not quite sure if you heard the message right or not, but it looks like he's going to be a bit caught out of position anyway, unfortunately.
Fergus Browning once again leads them around the bottom corner. Blake Quick, and there's been a fall, and the yellow jersey has gone down. He's amongst the victims in the fall. Team Bridge Lane also on the deck. That's Nick White, who sits in 10th position in the classification. Blake Angeletto was there also, and in 4th position across the line was Blake Quick. Blake Quick chose not to take the points in the race for the green jersey.
That's right. I think they would have sat up immediately, not knowing who was in that crash straight away. You want to make sure your teammates weren't involved, especially if they're teammates that are trying to go for the overall. These riders that definitely did touch down will get a lap out. Sometimes if you got caught behind a crash, that means that you don't get a lap out. So it is up to you to make sure you're in good position to avoid crashes. You do actually have to be part of the crash officially to be given that extra lap out.
Well, 3 riders inside the top 10 in the overall standings involved in the fall, and confirmation that Blake Quick didn't pick up any points in that intermediate sprint. It was Zach Marriage and his teammate Tom Chapman from Bridge Lane that were first and second across the line, followed by Fergus Browning. So now Tom Chester, with one sprint remaining, we'll go out the winner of the Mitchelton Wines points classification.
It's interesting to see Bridge Lane just put on the pace immediately following that crash, despite their leader in Nick Wong coming down. So it tells me that they're not really as invested in getting him into a bunch sprint situation anymore. They want more of an aggressive style of race and to take advantage of the chaos that comes from a crash like that.
Number 19 charging through the corner. Kurt Ether from the Keisha Park Up team. Cameron Ivory, the Australian Criterium champion. This is Blake Angeletto by the looks of it. Just adjusting the bike, getting himself resettled and into the peloton. It's one thing, Gracie, to survive the crash physically. The next challenge is to get back in the peloton and charge into that corner once again.
You're right. That is one of the most difficult parts of bike racing. Crashing hurts, but it's getting back on and fighting that mental part of it, just not being as scared to go through that corner again and potentially crash again. You don't know why you could have crashed. Sometimes it's a slippery corner, but to me it looked like a touch of wheels in this crash. So they're going to be backing off the wheel a lot more than what they were before, which means that you might have to be closing the gap every time now, and that makes your race harder as well.
There's number 32. That's Tom Chester. He's got the Mitchelton Wines green jersey on. And if our calculations are correct, I think they are, he will go out the winner of that competition. The yellow jersey, Graham Frizzley, rejoins after the crash. Team Bridge Lane, they're the ones who are forcing the pace. And one of their riders, 10th overall, Nick White, was also caught up in the crash. I haven't seen Nick White rejoin yet. This is a small peloton now, Gracie.
I can see that yellow jersey just making sure he's popping himself back into good position again. There wasn't even a chance for his teammates to stop and wait for him, but because of crit racing and the laps that they do get that lap out. So in a road race, you'd have teammates stop and try and drag that rider back to the bunch, because you're not going to get a lap out in a road race, but in a crit you do. So that's why they didn't have to wait for him. He's managed to slot himself nicely back in there. But Bridge Lane are really making this pace a lot higher than what they were before. So that's quite interesting to me. Are they setting it up for an attack, or did they want to isolate other riders and string it out?
What they are doing is they're definitely making it tough. Zach Marriage and Tom Chapman have been doing a lot of the work on the front. Slightly more nervous cornering at the back of the peloton too. That's understandable.
Even if you haven't crashed, The fact of watching a crash can also put you off as well. This course is always scary for many riders before they even have the gun go, but to watch a crash like that can really put you off. But the pace is getting quite high now. You can see some of the riders taking that wider line. It's tough sometimes to take the wider line. You might get pushed into the fence coming out of that second corner. but it means you can hold that speed a little bit higher as well. They're not actually apexing these corners as much as you might think. They're really taking a nice, smooth, circular line around the double corner, the hot dog shape.
A little over 15 minutes of racing remaining in the 2023 edition of the Citroën Bay Crits. Graham Frizzly, the yellow jersey, he leads by 4 points, but he has had a small touchdown. Brenton Jones is in second spot overall. He avoided the crash, but he's got a 4-point deficit. To close that gap, he needs to win the stage and have Graham Frizzly finish in third position or worse. And Graham Frizzly has moved himself straight back up behind Brenton Jones. Almost, he's just drifting a bit wide, isn't he, each time through that corner, Graham Frizzly. Not as smooth as he was prior to the crash.
He is taking it wider, but I think the reason he's taking it wider is he doesn't want to be in anyone's wheel. He wants to have a bit more space around him in case someone else crashes out as well. It's tough though if you're taking the outside line, because if someone crashes on the inside, suddenly you get taken out as well. So being off the wheel isn't exactly better or worse in that situation. It's just making sure that you're quite near the front and there's not too many riders around you at all in the first place. But on that lap before, I could see Brenton Jones having a good look around to see who was there, see what the favorites were looking like. He was probably trying to get eyes on Graham Frizzly to see how shaken he was after the crash.
Tom Chapman is the man who is on the front for Bridge Lane. He and Zach Marriage have been doing a lot of the pacemaking. The peloton continues to be reduced.
Bridge Lane continuing to keep the pace high. I'm not quite sure what their thoughts are behind this tactic. I would have thought that they would have left the pace setting to the Bayside Citroën team. I want to see what they're going to be making the most out of doing this to set the pace so high.
Well, we would have thought initially that their plan was to work for Nick White. He was involved in the crash. He's their noted sprinter. He's a former Australian under 23 road champion. Loves that race in Ballarat. It's where he was born and raised. He also loves crit racing. Yellow jersey has bounced back well. Is that one of his teammates alongside him in the green of the Cage Park Up team?
It does look like it.
Well, a little bit confusing for the Tom Chester green.
Something else I noticed was Blake Quick was also leaving a bit of a gap out of that corner. He's got Brenton Jones on his wheel. Another reason why you would leave a little bit of a gap and not just sprint so hard out of a corner is if you do have a rider that you're trying to sprint for, ride for in your wheel, it means that they're not accelerating as much either. And that was something that Brenton Jones brought up in that win after stage one, saying that his teammates made sure that he was as buffered from any surges in pace as possible. And that's one way that you can help a rider with that.
Well, potentially a good thing for Brenton Jones is the fact that Blake Quick now is mathematically out of contention for that green jersey, so he won't be wasting any energy on the final intermediate sprint, which is still another 8 minutes away or so. But Brenton Jones is just waiting patiently for the final big sprint finish, looking to pick up another stage victory. He won stage one. He got caught out on the final corner yesterday. Third through the corner that time, Tom Chapman. We've seen a lot of him on the front for Team Bridge Lane. Current Australian cyclocross champion. Handling the corners really well. Fergus Browning once again. Hasn't he been impressive today, the rider in the white colours?
Fergus Browning has done a great job on first two stages looking after his guys, and once again today showing that he is definitely worthy of being on that team, helping out Blake Quick and also doing the job of Luke Plapp. We can't see Luke Plapp in the bunch anymore. I think his job's done. He's got the legs up resting towards nationals. He did a huge effort at the start of this race, but now it's up to the rest of the Bayside Citroën team riders to make sure that Brenton Jones has the best chance of winning this bike race.
And importantly for Luke Platt, with what lies ahead in Ballarat and Buninyong, he's got all his skin together in one piece. The yellow jersey, Graham Frizzly, second on day one, first on day two. He's got a 4-point advantage over Brenton Jones, who won this series in 2014.
The bunch has whittled down quite a lot now because of this high pace in the middle portion of the race. You can't quite see because we've had so much focus on the front of the race, but it has been a race of attrition today. There's been riders popping off the back every lap, and they've really lost quite a number of riders now. It's coming down to the real pointy end of the race.
There is a big chance that we'll see a late attack from the Australian Criterium champion, Cameron Ivory. He's sitting towards the back. He's been quiet so far, gently getting nearer and nearer to the front as riders continue to get eliminated. There he is through the corner now in second last position behind Jacob Langham, who's been riding really well in this series. Jacob sits in sixth position in the overall standings. And look at how Cameron's doing it really. Everybody else is pedaling. Cameron is punched out of the corner and he just glides onto the wheel before the next one.
It's like he's racing an elimination race on the track, isn't it? He's just making sure that he's not the last rider across the line every time they lap through and making sure that he's not behind anyone getting dropped.
But he looks really in his corner and he's looking really focused on his exit speed. So as he's got a lot of momentum coming out the other side.
You certainly can control it to a certain extent. If you're in the rear of the peloton there, you can control it a little bit so you're not getting as much of that elastic band or the concertina effect. But he is sprinting out of the corners a little bit too much, more than what I would like to see. But I do hope that he's got the legs for a last-minute flyer, because I think that's going to make this race a little bit more exciting. The pace has just been so high, though. I don't see them letting up anytime soon.
Bridge Lane at the front and Bridge Lane at the back. It's Tom Chapman who is on the front, and it's Dalton Stretton at the rear of what is left of the peloton. 41 minutes down, not too far away from the final whistle in the race for the green jersey. Tom Chester, mathematically, he's got it all wrapped up, but locked together on 6 points in the race for second position. Connor Sens and Blake Quick. I don't think that Blake Quick will really contest the sprint for second position in that classification, given the job that he's got to do to protect Brenton Jones and try and support Jones to get the stage victory and the series win. There's Jones on the red bike with the white jersey behind him. On the blue with the white jersey, number one is Blake Quick.
Blake Quick is sitting behind Brenton Jones. He's doing a great job in making sure that Brenton is where he needs to be, and if he ever needs any help, say there's a gap that opens up, that Blake Quick will just quickly go around him and make sure that Brenton doesn't have to do much work at all. I do really think that Blake Quick is there to support Brenton Jones fully now. They could even go 1-2 on this stage. They did such a great job in the lead out on stage one. They gapped everyone through those last two corners. They've got the speed, the power, and the skills to do it. If they can do it on these final two corners, it's going to be very tough to beat them if they can go through in the first two positions.
I'm anticipating a huge battle for this bottom corner on the final lap. Jones has been here plenty of times before. First of all, as an eight-year-old, helping mum and dad put out the barricades. Then in the support race, he only lasted 10 minutes in his first participation in an elite race. He then won the series in 2014. He won stage one. This will be his final elite appearance in the Bay Crits. Fergus Browning at the front, doing the job for Jones. And now look at Frizzly in yellow. He is stalking Blake Quick because he knows Blake is the lead-out rider for Jones, his big rival.
Graham Frizzly doesn't have too many teammates to help him either, so he's making sure that he's trying to stay out of the wind, stay in the good wheels of Blake Quick and Brenton Jones. It's difficult sometimes when you don't have as much team support around you. There are a couple of Cache Park Up riders there that are trying to get in around him, make sure that he's doing all right. But Graham Frizzly is really making sure he's marking those two favourites in Quick and Jones.
One teammate that we can spot there, we see Daniel Luke in the green colours. The other green that you can see is not one of the teammates. That's the green of Tom Chester. So you're spot on with the lack of team support. It appears as if there's just one rider left there to look after Graham Frizzly from the Cache Park Up team, and that is Daniel Luke.
Sometimes in a situation like this, when the bunch is so strung out and there's only one other rider there, you can actually get in the way more than be helpful. So you can see as the bunch strings out and you're trying to be in front of your sprinter, you're actually getting more in the way, and they're putting their nose in the wind because they're not getting the sit that they need off those riders. So sometimes it is better to sit behind them, let them have the good wheels, have the good lines, and if they need help, that's where you can move up and around them.
Everyone through the corner safely. There's Daniel Luke just in front of the yellow jersey. Fergus Browning setting the tempo. Just behind him, it is Zach Marriage from Bridge Lane. Oh, no, in fact, it's Tom Chapman setting the tempo ahead of Fergus Browning. Then it is Zach Marriage. Three riders towards the front for Bridge Lane, one at the tail end of the peloton. And Cameron Ivory, the Australian Criterium champion, still dangerously in contact. I'm not expecting Cameron Ivory to go home without attacking.
I don't think so either. It's definitely in his nature, and he's probably wanting that little practice before the national championships. That's how he won last year at the Crit Nationals, was that flyer in the last lap. It's certainly a good opportunity to practice today. I do believe that this is the sprint lap coming in. I could hear the whistle as they went through that start-finish area.
It is the whistle. So this is the final of the intermediate sprints. And out in front is Tom Chester wearing the green jersey. Just for confirmation, he will be going out the winner of the Mitchelton Wines points classification. Well played, Tom Chester.
That's great. And he's making the most of this gap he's got. He sat up for a minute and then he realized how much gap that he had, and he put his hands back in those drops, took that corner pretty quickly and got back on the gas.
I'll be keeping a close eye on him next Friday, or this coming Friday on the 6th. It'll be live here on SBS for the Australian Criterium Championships. You know him a lot better than I do. How do you think he'll handle the climb on Sturt Street?
Look, he's showing that he's in great form. He's a smaller rider for this level of racing, whereas, you know, the Brenton Jones and the Kurt Ethers are bigger, more powerful riders. And Sturt Street is a bit of a drag up, so you do need to be a bit of an all-rounder when it comes to that. You need to be very quick, but you also need to be able to handle that high pace and going up the climb.
So Tom Chester, he wasn't eligible for the previous intermediate sprint because of the lap that he'd had out so close to the sprint, but he was made eligible for that sprint. He gets the 3 points. He had an unassailable lead anyway, but I like the way he put the exclamation mark on that victory in the race for the green jersey. Second across the line was Tom Chapman. Third across the line was Fergus Browning.
I can also see the ARA Skip Capital team getting quite organised the last few laps. The three of them have been sticking very closely together. They're looking after their man in Craig Wiggins. He's sitting in third overall. He can certainly challenge for the overall title as well. They're all so close on points. It is really going to come down to what points everyone gets on the final sprint.
Well, number 22, Daniel Luke. He's got plenty of experience when it comes to this style of racing to support Graham Frizzly. For the past couple of seasons, he's based himself in the Netherlands and in Belgium, doing the racing across the two borders of those small countries, which are famous for their criteriums in the Netherlands, and their Kermis is a very similar style of racing in Belgium. So Daniel Luke will know how to handle these conditions.
That's great experience, certainly for this level of racing, and arguably vice versa. This is great experience to get yourself over and race in the Kermesses and criterium racing in Belgium and Holland. So I'd certainly encourage anyone to try and get any opportunity to go race over there. You will learn a ton. If you've enjoyed the Bay Crits, then you'll love it over there too. It's a whole new world of skills and experience, and you will certainly get plenty of elbows in your side.
And one of the things that you learn when you race internationally is you learn all the swear words first, particularly when they're barked at you in the middle of a bike race.
That's right. You certainly do learn the language, but not the right kind of language, unfortunately.
Fergus Browning's learning the language of riding fast around corners in the Bay Crits. He has spent an inordinate amount of time on the front of the peloton. Fergus Browning has been super today.
Yes, he's just definitely been one of the most valuable players today in the peloton, especially for the Bayside Citroën team, doing a great job in keeping that pace high. Brenton Jones has been having a nice, easy ride in the wheels, being supported by Blake Quick, often behind him, sometimes in front of him, just making sure that he's protected, saving all of those watts that they're going to need for this final sprint.
47 and a half minutes of racing done. Getting desperately close to seeing the three lap board come out. You can feel the tension building in the fight to be up towards the front. This is Tom Chapman once again at the front for Team Bridge Lane. He has been super strong as well, just as we've seen from Fergus Browning. Kane Richards, the big figure from ARA Skip Capital, sweeping up the inside. He's got Wiggins behind him. They're starting to sort themselves out for the sprint finish. It's still a few laps away.
They're really charging out of these corners now. There is no chance for any rest. It's really difficult to now move yourself up into good positions. This is where having a teammate in this group becomes really important, having to sprint to get yourself into a better position. We can see Fergus Browning there sprinting into this corner to make sure he was there in front. Geez, they're going around there so quick now, aren't they, Matt?
Oh, the photographers, they're on the top corner, they're on the bottom corner, and each time the peloton comes through, they hold their breath. Bridge Lane still at the front. Fergus Browning in the white colours from Bayside Citroën takes a look across the shoulder at this point. Does he slot back in? Has he got anything left to support Brenton Jones? Jones has got Blake Quick there with him. An ideal teammate. They worked so well together last year when it was Click Quick who took the victory.
I really can't fault how Blake Quick and Brenton Jones are riding together. They've been able to stay around that top five, top eight position this whole time, despite the pace setting on the front. Their teammate in Fergus Browning has been one of those pace setters, making it their job a lot easier to stay in that position. But they've been elbowed around by the likes of Graham Frizzley, some of the ARA Skip Capital riders. It's really tough to keep that position for this whole time.
And Josh Duffy just patiently sitting in second spot for Team Bridge Lane. He keeps looking across the shoulder. We've seen Tom Chapman at the front. We've seen a lot of Zach Marriage, and Josh Duffy just waiting patiently. He's their man today for the sprint, because unfortunately for them, Nick White is out of contention.
I can see that green and gold jersey of Cam Ivory. He's ever so slowly making his way much further up the front now. He's done actually a great job in this elimination type of race at the back, to keep himself in there despite all of the sprinting out of the corners he's had to do. Not sure if he's going to have the legs now to be able to put in a last minute attack. I don't think that there's any other teammates left from the Novotel Bayside Prestige team anyway, so it is up to him to try and get a good result for that team.
And he's not too far away from the yellow jersey, who now slots behind Pat Eddy in the black colours. Three laps remaining. This is all that's left in the Citroën Bay Crits for 2023. The situation in the race for the yellow jersey, it is Graham Frizzley who leads. He's 4 points clear of Brenton Jones, who is just in front of him on the road. Jones needs to win the stage and have Frizzley finish outside the top three. It is tight as they head down the back straight.
You can see Brenton Jones there almost putting Graham Frizzley into the fence. It's getting very aggressive out there. They're not attacking, but they're certainly pushing each other around, jostling for the position they want to keep. These laps are short. You cannot give up your position at all. It's just too quick. You won't be able to get it back. Brenton Jones knows exactly where he wants to be. He's got the experience to hold himself there, and he's got a great support in Blake Quick, making sure that they're staying up near the front.
Two to go. Bridge Lane on the front. Marriage followed by Chapman, and then it's Duffy, their sprinter. Next in line is Quick. Jones is the second of the riders in the white colours. It's then Blake Angeletto, who is towards the front. Tom Chester still in contention. The yellow jersey, Graham Frizzley. It's a shuffling of the decks as they head down the back straight.
Team Bridge Lane have done a fantastic job. They've been really setting the pace for the second half of the race. They're putting a lot of confidence into their sprinter today in Josh Duffy. I really hope that he can have a good run, because they've really committed so much horsepower. But I think the experience of the Bayside Citroën team might overcome them. There's certainly a lot of other riders that are trying to get into a good spot as well. Graham Frizzley is finding it difficult without any team support.
The bell goes and the fight is on for positions. Frizzley fights his way just behind Jones. It's Blake Quick who now hits out down the back straight. Jones is behind him. They're trying to get over the top of Team Bridge Lane. Bridge Lane have had a lot of control. They've now been pushed aside.
This is a long way to go for Bayside Citroën. They want to be in the corner going into that last home straight, but is it too far out that they've gone? Graham Frizzley is on the wheel of Brenton Jones.
Angeluto tries to get up the inside of Frizzley. Quick through first. Jones in second position. Frizzley in the yellow jersey. If Frizzley finishes second behind Jones, he wins the series. But Graham wants to get the win. It is Jones in front. Jones for the stage. Frizzley for the series. Angeluto, or maybe Angeluto in second. We'll wait for confirmation. It could be equal on points and come to a count back. Jones has won two stages. Frizzley has won one. It looks like Blake got second. Jones may have won the series.
That was an exciting final few laps. Blake Quick did an amazing effort to go from so far out on that last, the corner coming into the last lap, being able to hold it all the way on that back straight into the final corner. That was a super long effort and a long sprint also by Brenton Jones to hold them off. Great sprinting by Graham Frizzley.
It could very well be coming down to the count back. I'm hitting refresh as rapidly as I can on the computer to get confirmation of the results. A huge performance by Brenton Jones. We will await confirmation. Here's another look at it. We'll just get a slight pause. And hearts are in mouths. It's the race for second and third. And I think Graham Frizzley knows that he was third across the line. Blake was in second, and that should be enough for Jones to win.
It was really hard to tell, but Blake Angeletto was certainly coming with some good speed. He was taking the wider line.
I can confirm that it was Blake Angeletto in second spot on the stage. Graham Frizzley was in third. Brenton Jones wins the stage. Brenton Jones moves to 30 points. Graham Frizzley is on 30 points. Brenton Jones has won two stages. Graham Frizzley has won one stage. Brenton Jones wins the series. Fairy tales do come true.
Wow.
And look at, and for Blake celebrating, Blake Quick that is, but what about Fergus Browning and his ride today? Let's head down to David McKenzie. He's just about ready to go with Brenton Jones.
Well, I'm with the winner of the final stage, final race of your professional career, Brenton Jones. There was a lot of emotions building to that, but you got the job done.
That was incredible. I can't swear, so I won't. That was amazing. I felt good all race. I was comfortable. I'm in really, really good form. I cannot do it without the team. The Bayside Citroën team, incredible job. You saw Plappy at the start, Ferg and the rest of the boys during the race, and Blake leading me out like I did for him last year. The camaraderie there is amazing, and incredibly proud to do it again, and to take the stage win was an amazing achievement.
You've got your family here, Lucy, close to giving birth, don't give birth. Must be great to have the whole family here supporting you in your final race.
Yeah, and no, I really appreciate the family support. It's a family event, as I've said many times in interviews. John's like a second father to me. It's an incredible event, so special to my family. I really appreciate Lucy, my wife as well, who's about to give birth, letting me do this race. Nationals is not on the cards, so I probably won't be there, but I'm really enjoying going to be a father soon and make the best of my future to come.
Well done, Brenton. I'll let you go and enjoy it. And well, and Karen Jones, as the mum and organiser of this event now, along with John Trevorrow, you must be very proud.
For once, I'm lost for words, Mecca. I just can't believe it. I am so proud. So proud of our entire family. We're all here. We're all part of this event. And yeah, really proud.
I'll let you enjoy it. Awesome. And here we've got our winner now in Graham Frizzley, right on cue. Come in here, Graham. Join us. You take the overall. You knew you had to finish in the top three. You've done that, I believe. So I believe you've won the series. You didn't know.
No. I thought I would have lost that on countback. That's a nice surprise. Super hard day out. Had that crash there about halfway through, so still pretty sore from that one. But I was happy to be able to get back into it. And yeah, well, I thought BJ had that in the end. So
well, he got the stage. Yeah. Was it panic stations when you came down? Talk us through that.
A little bit. It happened so fast, you can't really think too much. I had to get a new front wheel, so that was a bit of stress that I didn't really need. But no, I was super happy to get back in and still to be able to be there in the finish. It's awesome to be part of the new team. We had Dan out there helping me out, so that was awesome.
Well done, and we'll see you on the podium.
Thank you.
Well, there is a little bit of confusion as to who is the overall winner, because Brenton Jones and Graham Frizzley are both locked together on 30 points, and on the official result sheet, it has Brenton Jones as the winner ahead of Graham Frizzley. Either way, a huge day. We'll get confirmation of that result for you ASAP. Three generations of the Jones family involved. Karen Jones, Chris Jones, the mum and dad combination helped put this race on. Karen really the driving force. The red colours down to the left of screen. That's young Archer. That's Jared Jones' son. And Jared is part of the mechanical support for this event. And the race is going to go on with the James Jones family. I'm sure that we'll see Archer racing at some point in this series.
I do hope so, but Matt, I was tearing up a little bit there seeing how proud Karen was. I just want to say a big thank you to Karen Jones and John Trevorrow and all of the sponsors over the years of the Bay Crits. It's set up so many riders at the start of their career and been such a huge part of Aussie cycling, but it's also wonderful to see it bookending someone else's career, especially a Jones. So well done to Brenton Jones and a big thank you to Karen and John.
A huge performance by the entire team that puts the race together. They're getting organised down at Ritchie Boulevard for the presentation. There's no doubt about it in the women's race with Ruby Roseman Gannon going out a comfortable winner of the series. Just trying to make contact with somebody at the finish line to get it absolutely locked in as to that final finishing order. There was a little bit of confusion there, as you could see in the end with that interview with Graeme Frizzley. Frizzley certainly looked like that he thinks that the calculation is that initially when he went across the finish line, that finishing third and being on equal points has him in second position in the series. But wow, what a day.
Either way, we're really happy to see Brenton Jones take out that final stage because it's the end of his career, but it's a very amazingly well-ridden race by Graeme Frizzley as well, so he's done really well. We'll just wait for the results, but him and the Cache Park Up team did a great job to make sure that he was in a good position to try and take the win today and take the overall victory. We saw some other awesome racing from the ARA Skip Capital team, Team Bridge Lane, that really lit it up at the final half of that race today. I think we could see some really good racing to start this 2023 season of racing and the summer of cycling, and a great taste for what's coming up at the Nationals this weekend.
Well, the overall result is still being confirmed, so stick with us. We're not going anywhere until we get confirmation. There is no official winner that has been announced by the race officials at this point, so we're sitting tight. We're holding our breath. It will come down to a count back. Can't they split the prize and give two yellow jerseys, Gracie? It doesn't happen like that, does it?
No, unfortunately it doesn't. They could certainly split a bottle of wine though, couldn't they? I'm sure there's a few bottles of Mitchelton going around there, but it is good to try and get this cleared up as quick as possible so they can enjoy those podium celebrations and enjoy some time with their friends and family that have all come out to watch.
The judges are currently working out the exact ruling on the count back. We have two stage victories for Brenton Jones, one stage victory for Graeme Frizzley. Phil Liggett is down there as well, and he's making that communication to the audience as well, that they're still waiting to confirm exactly what is happening with the result. And Phil has spent a little bit of time himself at the Jones family house in Warrigal.
That's right. He loves going down to that Geelong region. I've even spent a bit of time with Phil Liggett down there on one of Jerry Ryan's boats, which was a pretty nice experience one time down there. So it's certainly a great spot to go to. The Novotel has done a great job in also being one of the sponsors of this event. They're on one of the primo locations down there on the waterfront. I'm sure Phil likes going there too for his morning coffee and his walk along with those amazing painted bollards.
So we've got some news for you. We've got a race result. We've got a winner on a count back. It is Brenton Jones who goes out the winner of the series. So our initial thoughts, Gracie, were right. It is Jones with the win. And Karen, the tears will continue to flow, I'm sure, and rightly so.
That's very good news. We certainly were very proud of Graeme Frizzley's ride and this series so far, but I think we're really happy that Brenton can take away that yellow jersey overall and take it home to mum.
The fantastic family result for the Joneses. Congratulations to Ruby Rose Manganon taking out the women's race. It was Brenton Jones taking out the men's race. Thanks for joining us for the 2023 Citroën Bay Crits on behalf of the entire team at SBS. We hope that this is just the beginning of a really big year. We're sure that it is, and it will continue on Friday when we're up in Ballarat for the national championships. Until we meet again with more bike racing at hand, it's bye for now. Gotta dream about it. Gotta find a way to do the things that make you feel alone. Gotta think about it. Gotta dream about it. Gotta find a way to do the things that make you feel alone.
Breathe in, breathe out. Here, you're surrounded by silence. You feel in total harmony with your movement, with the world. Here, you simply feel serene, at peace.
All new Citroën C5X.
The spirited traveller eagerly anticipates the sea of possibilities the new adventures bring. The unwritten paths, unexpected journeys, and unforgettable memories that lay just beyond the horizon. Discover Spirit of Tasmania Key Geelong, where a new adventure begins. Be a spirited traveller.